disciples are here. The Holy Ghost is moving, moving in my life. Signs and wonders now. Miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving, moving in my life. Signs and wonders now. Miracles are here. Holy Ghost is moving, moving in my life. Lay hold on God, lay hold on God, lay hold on life, His eternal life. Lay hold on God, take hold of God, lay hold. Miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving, moving in my life. Lay hold on God. Take hold of God. Lay hold on life. His eternal life. Lay hold on God. Take hold. Miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving, moving in my life. Signs and wonders now. Miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving, moving in my life. Lay hold on God. Lay hold. Lay hold on life.
with God. Filled now with God. Filled now with God. And overflowing. Filled now with God. Filled now with God. Filled now with God. And overflowing. Oh, I'm filled now with God. And overflowing these mighty streams, rivers of God, wellspring of God in me now dwelling. These mighty streams, these rivers of life, wellspring of God in me now. Hold of God, take hold of God. I lay hold on life, His eternal life. I lay hold on God, I take hold of God. I lay hold on life, His eternal life. Oh, for miracles are here, miracles are here. Signs and wonders now, miracles are here. Holy Ghost is moving in my life. With signs and wonders now, miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving, moving in my life. Oh, signs and wonders, miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving, moving in my life. Oh, signs and wonders, miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving, moving in my life with signs and wonders. Oh, miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving, moving in my life. Cannot be fathomed, miracles that can't be counted. But you perform wonders that cannot be fathomed, miracles that can't be counted. But you perform wonders that cannot be fathomed. Miracles that can't be counted. Would you perform wonders that cannot be fathomed? Miracles that can't be counted. Would you perform wonders that cannot be found? Miracles that can't be counted. Oh, everlasting, everlasting, everlasting God. Oh, everlasting, everlasting, everlasting God. You are the everlasting, the everlasting, the everlasting God. In all the depths of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God, unsearchable. Oh, the depths of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God, unsearchable, 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 unsearchable. Unsearchable, you're great. Unsearchable, unsearchable, unsearchable. Oh, the depths of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God. Unsearchable. The depths of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God, unsearchable. Oh, the depths of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God, unsearchable, unsearchable. Unsearchable, unsearchable, oh, full of grace and full of truth, how majestic are you? You're full of grace, full of truth. Majestic are you, Lord.
unsearchable, infinite, unsearchable, unsearchable. Your greatest, Father, your greatest Lord. Oh, the depths of your love. Oh, the depths of your love fills my soul. Unsearchable, 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 unsearchable. You are full of grace, full of truth. How majestic are you, oh Lord? You're full of grace. True, how majestic are you, oh Lord? Full of grace, full of truth. How majestic are you? Know the depths of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God. Oh, the depths of the riches of the wisdom and knowledge of God. Unsearchable, unsearchable, unsearchable. Oh, your greatness, unsearchable, unsearchable. How unsearchable, unsearchable. Infinite, infinite, indescribable, your greatness. Full of grace, full of truth. How majestic are you, O Lord? Full of grace, full of truth. Majestic God, your compassions fail not, your mercy unending God. Oh, what riches your glory, your awesome glory, God. Your greatness beyond compare, Almighty God, Sovereign Lord, Sovereign God, Holy, Holy, Holy is your name. Oh, Holy, Holy, Holy are you, Lord. And worthy, worthy, worthy of all praise. Oh, Holy, Holy, Holy are you, Lord. Worthy, worthy, worthy of all praise. Oh, holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. And worthy, worthy, worthy of all praise. Oh, holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. And worthy, worthy, worthy of all praise. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. And worthy, worthy, worthy of all praise. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. And worthy, worthy, worthy of all praise. Holy, holy, holy. Are you, Lord? And worthy, worthy, worthy of all praise. Sing and say, holy, holy, holy are you, Lord. one, creator of the ends of the earth, maker of all things, creator of the ends of the earth, maker of all things, my maker, creator, sovereign Lord. Holy, holy, holy are you, Lord, and worthy, worthy, worthy of all praise. Oh, holy, holy, holy are you, Lord, and worthy, worthy, worthy of all praise. Oh, holy, holy, holy are you, Lord, and worthy, worthy, worthy of all praise. For your arms so wide, they hold the skies. In your arms so wide, they hold the universe inside. In your arms so wide, they hold the skies. In your arms so wide, they hold the universe inside. And you're holding on to me, holding on to me, you're holding on to me, holding on to me, you're holding on to me, holding on to me. This love, this love, this love beyond compare. This love, this love, this love beyond compare. This love, this love beyond compare. Oh, this love, oh, this love beyond compare. Your arms so wide, they hold the skies. In your arms so wide, you hold the universe inside. But your arms so wide, they hold the skies. Your arms so wide, they hold the universe inside. And you're holding on to me, oh Jesus, you're holding on to me, oh, you're holding on to me, you're holding on to me, you're holding on to me, you're holding on to me. This love, this love, this love beyond compare. Oh, this love, this love, this love beyond compare. This love, this love, this love beyond compare. Oh, this love, this love, this love beyond compare. Ageless, endless, indescribable, inseparable love. Love of God, how rich, how sure, how measureless and strong your love. Oh, the love of God, how rich, how sure, how measureless and strong your love. Oh, the love of God, how rich, how sure, how measureless and strong your love. Oh, the love of God, how rich, how sure, how measureless and strong your love. Oh, so forever will I sing. Oh, forever will I sing of your love. Oh, forever will I sing, forever will I sing of your love. You're a failing love. You're a failing love. forever will I sing, forever will I sing, forever will I sing of your amazing love, oh, amazing love. Oh, forever will I sing, forever will I sing, forever will I sing of your unfailing love. Forever will I sing, ever will I sing of your amazing love. Oh, Father, you love. Oh, forever will I sing, forever will I sing, forever will I sing of your unfailing love. Oh, for the love of God, how rich, how measureless and strong your love. Oh, the love of God, how rich, how sure, how measureless and strong your love. Oh, the love of God, how rich, how sure, how measureless and strong your love. And you're holding on to me, holding on to me, you're holding on to me, Jesus, you're holding on to me, you're holding on to me. Oh, this love, oh, this love, this love beyond compare. Oh, this love, oh, this love, this love beyond compare. Oh, this love, this love, this love beyond compare. This love, this love, this love beyond compare. Oh, so forever will I sing, forever will I sing, forever will I sing of your amazing love, oh Lord. Oh, forever will I sing, forever will I sing, forever will I sing of your amazing love. Oh, forever will I sing, forever will I sing, forever will I sing of your amazing love. Forever will I sing, forever will I sing of your amazing love, Lord Jesus. Oh, forever will I sing, forever will I sing, forever will I sing of your amazing love. Oh, you rejoice in your love. Oh, you shout over us. You shout over us, O Lord, and you rejoice over us, your people. You're our God, and we are your people. We are yours. We are yours, and we rejoice in you. you are always sure. A helper to the helpless, a strength to those who care, Lord. You are, Lord, you are, Lord, you are ever faithful, and you are always sure. A helper to the helpless, a strength to those who care, Lord. You are, yes, you are. In God of all creation, sovereign is your name. The wonders of the universe declare your mighty fame, Lord Jesus. Oh, Lord Jesus. Oh, God of all creation, sovereign is your name. The wonders of the universe declare your mighty fame, Lord Jesus. And you are ever faithful, you are always sure. Help to the helpless, strength to those secure, Lord. You are, you are God of all creation. Sovereign is your name. The wonders of the universe declare your mighty fame, Lord Jesus. Oh Lord Jesus, oh Lord Jesus, oh Lord Jesus. Oh, and we declare your wonderful works. We declare the glory of your name, Jesus. You are ever faithful. You are always sure. A helper to the helpless, a strength to those secure, Lord, you are. It's worthy as the Lamb, guys. Worthy as the Lamb. Worthy as the Lamb. Worthy, 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 worthy. I'll forever say worthy. Worthy as the Lamb. Worthy as the Lamb. Worthy as the Lamb. Christ Jesus, who redeemed my soul. You redeemed my soul, Lord Jesus. You're my salvation. You're my salvation. You're my salvation. My salvation. Oh Jesus, my salvation. My salvation. Jesus, you're my salvation. Would you my salvation? You're my salvation, Jesus. Your whole salvation. If you are ever faithful, oh, you are always sure. A helper to the helpless. Secure, Lord, you are, Lord, you are, only you are. You are ever faithful, and you are always sure. A helper to the helpless, strength to the secure, Lord, you are. In God of all creation, sovereign is your name. The wonders of the universe declare your mighty fame, Lord. Jesus. You're the God of all creation. Sovereign is your name. The wonders of the universe declare your mighty faith, Lord Jesus. Oh, Lord Jesus. Name above all names. Jesus, you're the name above all names. You're the name above all names. You're the name above all. You're the name above all. Lord Jesus, name above all. And every knee will bow and every tongue confess. Jesus Christ is Lord. Jesus Christ is Lord. You're my Lord. You're my Savior. Jesus Christ, my Lord. Oh, Jesus Christ, my Lord. Oh, Jesus Christ, my Lord. Jesus Christ, my Lord. And you're my salvation. You're my salvation. Lord, you're my salvation. Oh, the King of Glory. You're my salvation. King of Kings and Lord of Lords. You're my salvation. You're my salvation.
Thank you, Jesus. Hallelujah. Come on, let's bring praise into the house of the Lord. Let's bring praise into the house of the Lord. Ha. Give praise from the depths of your soul. Give praise from the depths of your spirit. Give praise to the Almighty Sovereign God. Come on and enter in into the house of the Lord. Give praise, give praise, give praise, for He's worthy of all praise. Let the prophecy flow. Let the Spirit flow. Let the rivers of God flow out of you right now in Jesus' name. touched tonight like never before. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you for your presence, God. Thank you for your presence, Lord. Well, I'm just here to introduce, with such an honor, with such pleasure, Pastor James Levesque. Tonight, oh, we're so, come on, lift up your voices. Church, don't forget to be in the house Saturday and Sunday with Pastor Sabino. Thank you, Jesus.
Come on, that's a piece of heaven. Let's give the Lord a hand. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Come on. Well, you could be seated for a moment. Hope you're well tonight. And I can't tell you again what a great honor it is to be here at Abiding Place. And can we welcome everybody watching on live stream tonight? Come on, give them a hand. I know we have people back home watching. It's later for them. But it's a real honor to be here, and there's no secret. I love your pastor. He's in Oregon. Can we give him a hand? Come on, that'll be last time we clap. You know, I remember there were times that I would travel and tell these just amazing stories of just what God does and what he's doing in New London, New England, and I mean just crazy stuff, right? Like miracles and people getting set free from, you know, addictions. And I remember not too long ago, I was out on the road and somebody ran up to me after the service and they're like, man, I need to go to your church. And I'm like, that's awesome. Yeah, you know, we're here 11 a.m. on Sundays and we do our fire nights. And she's like, man, I've been looking my whole life for a church that's like just filled with people that are operating in signs and wonders and you know, just radically giving and demons come out, you know. And man, she's hyping this thing up and I was getting excited. I was like, wow. This is really, I want to go to this church. You know what I mean? I was like, man, this is. And then she's like, I've never found a place, and I'm sure that's it, you know? And I'm like thinking, no, dude, that's not really it, actually. And I started getting angry, like mad at my people. You know what I mean? I was like, what? This is, they should be doing, you know what I mean? And I'll never forget, and they do. I mean, they're radical like you guys, but I'll never forget, I went home and I did a leaders meeting. I said, listen, man. I never want the name Engaging Heaven or the idea of what we are to be bigger than what you actually carry. I said, because I can't go on the road and just release a piece of what God has done in me and you not live to your potential. And look, there's no secret about it, man. I think if there's something that God wants you to know is that it can't be the same for this place. Around the world, this is a radical place, man. Among people from all the nations of the earth, you know, our church, it's like you think this place hung the moon. But it's because of what your pastor has broken open and what he sacrificed and what he's given so radically to the kingdom and what he stands for and what God has given him. I mean, you want to talk about revelation, my God. But man, I don't ever want it to be said that it's, you know, Dr. Mark, and then, man, you've got to live to what you're called to do. And if you're not thriving and you living every day for what God has for you, then man, what is the point, really? Because it's to equip you for the work of the ministry. And so, you know, it's not bad to ask yourself things like, you know, I remember I was teaching at a Bible school in Toronto. You know, I was like 200 kids and, you know, this is like a big, you know, revival school. And I mean, for our dear friends up there. And I'm talking to like a couple hundred kids, and I'm just like, I was supposed to teach on like power evangelism and miracles, and I kind of just stopped somewhere in the meeting, and I was like, you know, I led this person to Christ. I mean, you know, just sharing about an encounter I shared with someone, and they just lifted their hand. I was in a mall, and I was just like, lift your hands, and the fire God hit them, and you know, I mean, we're seeing people just get filled with the Holy Ghost. So, I mean, you got to actually figure out when they got saved. You know what I mean? It's like we had football teams coming out of the school, and we're like, you ever been filled with the Holy Ghost? I mean, forget the beginning. So we go right to like home run, And we're just like, lift your hands. And we just call fire. And they just start screaming in tongues, falling on the ground. We've been, maybe you need to go home and figure out when salvation took place. But I'm going to go ahead and say they're in. You know what I mean? But I'll never forget, I'm talking to these kids. And I was like, do you even know how to, like, when was the last, do you even know how to share your faith? I mean, it was a weird question. I'm not just talking about a memorized approach. I'm saying, like, in everyday life, like, do you know the gospel? And I'm talking to Bible school students, or supposed to be. And I'm just like, dude, when was the last time any of you shared your faith and just, like, you know, just went for it? And these people hadn't. I was like, raise your hands. Friends, not a hand went up. And I was like, oh, no. And I was like, when was the last time I was like, look, do any of you even know how to share your faith? And no hand went up. And then I was like, how many of you prophesied? Every hand went up. I was like, how many of you tried to fly? Yes, friends. Like a bird, dude. These people are jumping off cliffs trying to fly, but nobody's living it in their everyday life. That was the last time I got invited back, to be honest with you. I almost ripped these people in half. I was just like, why are you even a Christian? Because the bottom line is you weren't created. You know, I love, you know, in Connecticut, the winter's so bad. I mean, like, really bad. Like, it snowed like 4 feet a few weeks ago. I'm not exaggerating. And it gets so gnarly that, you know what thrives? Greenhouses. Man-made structures that, you know, if you go to our little cheesy zoo, you know, there's like a tropical exhibit, and you walk in and it's hot and it smells like, you know, manure, and there's like bird noises being played, and you might get one snake hanging, and they're trying so hard to replicate it. But greenhouses flourish. Why? Because it's a controlled environment that you can grow in. But we're not sure how those plants could ever live until it faces elements, until it breaks down. This is like an amazing greenhouse. Like, in this moment, everybody thrives. Everyone feels it. It's like when the greenhouse isn't here. I did like 30, 40 days last year in Jacksonville, Florida, and it was like powerful, man. I mean, crazy miracles. We did about 30 days, and I wouldn't even call it revival. I would just say it was an invitation for people to step into a new life. But I wanted like an artifact, a memory. So don't judge me. I bought a palm tree, dude. I literally was like, I need, you know, you're all laughing. You take it for granted. They're probably under your feet. Dude, there ain't nothing like that where I live. And I said, I'm going to get one from Florida, and I'm going to put it in the Northeast. And I found a company was like, it will live in your zone. Your zone 6, we guaranteed, or you get your money back. And I was like, oh, dang, I'm in. Here's the problem. The palm tree itself was expensive. Then shipping the palm tree, beep, 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 just dropping this thing in my house was expensive. And then how did I ever know Connecticut has a palm tree tax? Has anyone before me done this? So it's like a $350 palm tree. Like they're so angry at anybody that would ever want to disrespect our land by bringing a palm tree in. Or they're thinking, like, you must be in a different tax bracket. So the minute that thing crosses our border, you pay me $350. So I had to pay $350 for this thing. And they assured me. I didn't have to, like, pamper it and cover it and put a little zipper on it. They're like, it can live. So, friends, I dug this thing up, put it in my house all summer long. I was the coolest person on the planet. Everything's flourishing. It's all beautiful. It's like, you know, 10 feet tall. And, well, then the winter came. After the first snowstorm, it was cute. The second one, I still sent pictures to my friends in the South. About the fourth snowstorm, friends, this thing was haggling. I mean, it was like, didn't even look like a palm tree. I had a little 5-foot one in a big pot. It was like dying. I had to bring it in the house. let's just say I might be getting a refund, okay? I don't know what it's going to look like when I get home. This thing is, like, drooping over the most depressed-looking palm tree. Honestly, it's falling apart. I'm embarrassed to show it to people. It's like you come to my house, and now, you know, when I got it, I was like the palm tree. I was like, wow, you're powerful. You know what I mean? You got revival artifacts and money, and I'm like, yeah, I got the only palm tree. Well, now it's like I'm the guy that kills trees. You know what I mean? It's like you come to my house, and I'm like, yeah, sorry, I didn't know. You know, I wouldn't have done this to him. But you know something? You never really know what you carry until it's activated. And so in one atmosphere, something can thrive, but unless we actually go through, you know, the Bible says in Romans that we must reign in this life. But it's not until you actually start reigning in life do you even realize what you carry. It's not until you actually go through life and go through situations, you know, the bottom line is whatever we believe here, we've got to believe outside these doors. And I mean, like, it's not even, I don't even mentally have to prepare. Listen, when the fire of God touched my life, there was nothing like this where I lived. And I just knew in my heart that I wanted everything God had, and there wasn't a barrier around me that was going to stop it. There's not a religious devil in hell was going to stop it. If the Bible says I could do it, friends, it wasn't even a question. Like, it wasn't, I didn't have 30 years of barren Christianity to talk me out of it. When I was working, if somebody, I mean, I remember I was managing a coffee shop, and friends, I don't got a GED doing this. I was running a coffee shop, three of them, and I'll never forget, at one point, my general manager came in, he was like, James, I'm a believer too, but you've got to stop casting out devils. They're like the home office, because I work for a company, they called themselves Christian, and they put a little scripture on the cup. Well, don't tell me that, because I don't know what kind of, I didn't know there was different Christians. I'm like, oh, you're a Christian? Great, so am I. Dude, I mean, I had a whole gypsy family like puking in my office. And they're looking at it on film and they're like, dude, what are you doing? And I'm like, the guy started manifesting. What do you want me to do? You know, feeling like I'm Brother Yun or something. You know what I mean? Like I'm going through persecution. Oh, you guys are late on jokes now. What is happening? Where are you? What time zone? But for me, it was like, your faith isn't really valid until you operate it. And the thought of somebody being in a safe place for so long, but it never applying to you, didn't even occur to me until I started seeing churches. You know, I remember I was in Italy and I was ministering on the streets and you know, and even in Paris, and they don't do that kind of stuff. And I'll never forget one night I'm praying with the pastor and the Lord gives me a word of knowledge. And I got up it wasn't that late. It was like 11. We're kind of like peace out and for the night. And I came back and I said to the pastor, I said, no, God wants to touch somebody in these streets tonight. And he's looking at me like, do you know where you are? And I said, no, man. I said, and I wrote down everything. I mean, I can't write this off because I've turned it on, and for me, there's no other place in life. And as I'm going to sleep, I get this word of knowledge, and I write the words A-M-E-N. And I'm just like, I don't know what it means. Biblically, maybe so be it. But I said, here's the name God gave me. And I'm going to tell you something else. This guy's a soccer player. And I started writing down like his jersey number and what team he played for and how God wanted to encounter him. And what is the pastor? The pastor's looking at me like, what are you doing? And I basically was like, look, if you don't take me on these streets right now, because I thought everybody believed this stuff, man. I didn't think it was like just pulpit talk. I said, if you don't take me on these streets right now, I'm going to go out there, I'll deliver somebody by tongues, and they're going to be my interpreter. And then he said, okay, I'll go with you. So this guy is literally trying to talk me out of this word for an hour. It's cold. We're in Italy. It's dark. I mean, it's not, you know, this ain't San Diego lights. You know what I mean? It's like you might get a tiny light on a street corner. Other than that, it's alley to alley. And we're walking, and I'm like, no. And he's like, well, maybe it was for another day, or maybe it was, for America. And just everything he could do to get out of it. And finally, there was a whole, there was a whole bunch of like young people sitting outside a Catholic church. And I would go up to people. I would say, does this mean anything to any of you? Or no. What does this name mean? No. And there was all these people outside a Catholic church, and they run up to me. And they just start talking like they were the evangelist. I'm like, oh my gosh, what are they saying? The pastor's like, they want to know if you have cocaine. I was like, well, this ain't funny. I'm like, no, what? Because I have tattoos and I'm white? I mean, what do they think I have? So it was almost like a silver and gold moment, but they wanted drugs. You know what I mean? So it's like, cocaine and heroin I do not have. I literally had to like translate this, buddy. Cocaine and heroin I do not have, but such as I have, I'm going to have to give you. And I started talking to these people, and I said, why are you here? Like, what do you, why are you out here? And they said, this is what they told me. They said, because the Catholic Church won't accept us. Because I wasn't confirmed or whatever, or sprinkled or kicked. I don't know, whatever they do. I wasn't all these things, so they won't accept us. And they want, and because when I walked in their doors, they said, are you Catholic? And I said, oh, my family's Muslim. And they said, well, you can't come in the church. So they're hanging out outside the church in this massive palace that won't receive them. And finally, I showed the paper. I'm like, is any of you this? And sure enough, man, there was a guy there, and his name was Amin. And he spelled it A-M-E-N, and every single thing I wrote down was his life. I mean, he's a soccer player. I called out his number the whole day. The guy gets completely set free. I tell them, you can come to my meeting the next day. Because I'm a pastor. They're like, no way. I'm like, yeah, you come sit on the front row. Not like the Catholic. Not like this bad place. You come sit on the row to my meeting, and Jesus will accept you and touch your life. But there's two things here. One, the Catholic, they're having such a crisis in Italy because nobody will take the, whatever you want to call it, nobody will be a priest. They can't get anybody to be crazy and, you know, whatever you got to do, wear a dress, be celibate. They can't get nobody to sign up for this because a whole generation of people are looking at them and they're saying, wait, this thing hasn't set you free. So how am I going to give my life to what you do? And so a whole religion that was at one point one of the most powerful forces is dying off because a generation is going, bro, you don't even live this. Because your faith isn't activated until you put it into practice. Like, we have to stop looking at conflict as a problem. Conflict is not an issue, it's an opportunity. When I have an opportunity to destroy the works of the devil, I love it. It gets me excited. Because that's why we're on this earth. But we live in a day that trains you to think, oh no, you know, or the early church tries to judge you if something happens in your life. It's like, no, that's why you're on this earth. And we took everybody to the meeting the next day, and we were in this place called Treviso, Italy, and I'll never forget, we were worshiping. It was kind of like an outdoor thing, really, where there was a roof and the sides were open, and I'm preaching, and it's hot, and all of a sudden, as I'm preaching, this guy walks in, and he sits at the back of the room, and I'm preaching, and I can't get my eye off the kid. I mean, he's just kind of hippie looking, you know what I mean, kind of nasty, like he should take a bath or something, and he's sitting in the bath, his hair's all long, and he's just kind of has his head hung. And I see this angel behind him. And the angel had six arms. And each arm was an instrument. And I saw him in the back, and I'm trying to preach and do my thing, but I just couldn't get my eyes off that guy. So finally I said, hey, this kid in the back, you need to get up here right now. I said, you don't even recognize what's happening behind you. And I told him the vision. He didn't want to come up. He's kind of looking reluctant, looking around the room. He finally gets up. He starts walking. He collapses on the floor, and God's clearly doing something with this kid. And I prayed over him, I released this, because, man, I saw an angel of, like, worship and creativity like I've never seen, man. And I don't just say those things lightly. I don't just have angelic things all the time. And he weeps. And the guy stands up and he grabs the microphone and he's like, my cover's blown. And I'm like, what's happening? The dude tells us that he was a Hillsong United main worship leader and he messed up, fell in drugs, fell in sin, and he left the church and he hid in Italy for like 8 months running from God. And he's in all the early albums and he's on the streets as I'm preaching and he hears English, this message about God's fire and his power, and he comes in the room and then I give him that word of knowledge. Let me tell you something. I took that kid off the ground. I said, tomorrow I'm gonna give you a guitar, whatever you do, and I'm gonna put you in the field and we're just gonna do worship. Hundreds got saved. I mean, the next day, the dude literally just seeing the potential of what he has activates it overnight, and the guy's like still there doing crazy stuff. You know, one of the biggest downfalls we can have is being ignorant of what we really possess. Understanding is everything. Such as I have, I give to you. But few believers really recognize what you've been given. Or we waste our time asking God for something that he's already given us. And I'm telling you, when the light goes on in your life and it becomes not just the God of my father or the God of it, but it's your God, and there's a moment in your life, you know, the whole miracle of silver and gold have I none. The reason why it was so radical is because that's really the first recorded miracle after the ascension. So Jesus leaves, and now you see a recorded. It could have been earlier. And you see this moment where Peter and John are walking, and this man is lame, and he's asking for money. Guess what the easy thing to do in that moment is? Please, what the church does. Drop coin in the irritating, you know, Salvation Army guy ringing the bell every store I try to go in at Christmas. That's the easy thing. There's no anointing needed for that. But there's a moment where they have to look at this lame man and go, man, can you imagine the thoughts that are flooding? We know what should be going on. We know what would happen if Jesus Christ was standing here right now. But then this flesh part of you is like, give them money and you're doing your thing, or just donate it away. And they look at this man and there's a moment in their life where they say, will this work for me? You know, I know what should be happening. I know if Jesus Christ was here right now, this wouldn't even be an issue. And they said, silver and gold I don't have. Friends, that doesn't mean they were poor. That means that isn't what was on their mind. But they said, what I do have, I'm going to give to you in the name of Jesus. Rise up and walk. And that was the first moment that it worked for them. And in every single one of your lives, there's a moment that must come that you stand on that place. I'm not talking about in the healthy confines of this place. I'm talking about in life, where you are looking at something in the face and you have to answer that question, will it work for you? And it's silver and gold have I none, but such as I have. You know, I remember years ago asking Pastor Mark about business. And, you know, I mean, he's seen so much success in his life and so many things that he's done. And I remember asking, almost like I'd get a 40-year shortcut. And I'm like, dude, you got to tell me. Like, what can I do? Like, what, do I need to create a crane? Like, what's your deal? And you know what he said to me? He said, I can tell you everything I know, but you're going to have to play it out in your own life and make it work. Because you can't just hear a success principle and somehow think it's your life. You know, in Luke chapter 8, Jesus is walking with thousands of people and a woman touches him. And he turns around and he says, who touched me? Let me tell you something, man. That alone was an indictment on the disciples. Because the truth is, they were touching him. And when they looked at him and he said, who touched me? They said, wait, what kind of, is this a joke? Like, do you realize everybody's touching you? And he said, no, I felt virtue go out from me. Let me tell you something. If I was walking with this dude and I was a disciple, I'd be like, bro, you stink. We're touching him and this little bleeding woman comes, don't matter, she's a woman, this little bleeding person comes from nowhere, and she swipes him, and dude stops, and he's like, oh, pow. I'm like, well, I've been touching you all day. It's an indictment on the disciples, because I'm going to tell you something, you can be that close to Christ and not pull what he has for you out from him. You can walk with him, or you can be in an atmosphere like this and not get what he has for you, because everybody seems to be touching him. And I'm not looking for those that are just crowding around something that's amazing. I'm looking for those that will manifest the power of God and will show the virtue of touching Christ. You know, there's this young man that came in our church. I don't even know where he came from. And he just came out of nowhere, and he's this young guy named Richard, and he's like, I mean, he's only been saved like 2 years. But really, he barely been saved, because for a year and a half, he's in this demonic church. And it's so bad, because when you've been spiritually raised wrong, you're a mess. And he comes to one of our big conferences, and God just touches him, man. And he's crazy. He's sucking up every ounce of God in the room. Everything I'm saying, he's like standing on his feet, and he's listening to every word as if he's never heard it before. And people think he's weird, and I love him because I see myself in him. And he's just believing it, and he's like, you know, I mean, he's just crazy. And the kid is like, he's like scared to look at me in the face after the meeting, because he's just so in awe of God, and he just wants everything. And all of a sudden, out of nowhere, I mean, the guy wasn't even, I didn't even know who he was. Out of nowhere, people are like, dude, he's pulling people out, he's laying hands on the sick, he's seeing all these things. And I was like, what? And I look, and I have to Facebook friend the guy. I'm like, I need to see his testimonies. And I'm seeing everything. He's listening to the messages, and he's just doing it. Man, I went to some of my own leaders. I'm like, that's shame on you, bro. You sit in this meeting and you think that the only way you can operate is on this platform. You're a mess. This dude comes in off the street and he just hears this and he goes and does what you used to do 10 years ago. You need to go in the back row and I need to put Richard up front. I can't do anything with you. Because this gospel was never meant to be about stopping. Or somehow waiting for the right. It was about every single day, every single moment, every single breath that it is activated in you. I was speaking at a full gospel businessman, man. It was like this old organization. It's like 5,000 men, and they're all into like tests, because they're like the 60s and 70s. They're like into testimonies, which we love testimony. They had these guys, you know, and they win for testimony of the year. You know what I mean? This guy gets up, he's like, 1970s, I killed everyone, and I was on the most wanted. I mean, you win if you're looking for that. But it dawned on me that every single testimony was like the 70s and 80s. And I get up there, and I'm like, does anyone have a testimony from, like, I don't know, yesterday? Come on. I'm like, this is the most stagnant, dead thing I've ever seen. God is not impressed with your rehearsed 1970s testimony. And no one thinks you're cool because you killed people. You're nuts. Paul did, but you know what he did? He wrote 2/3 of the Word of God and seen people raised from the dead. You're up here with some 1970s biker ponytail looking like you're nuts. And you're telling me some crusty testimony like it just happened. Bro, you're like 80. I'm so done with your like 20 year ago deal, man. With your 5 year ago, it means nothing to me. Whatever happened to what give us today our daily bread? Whatever happened to this day, make a decision. Every day is a supernatural moment. And if you fail to have, I mean you, you know, I'm not talking about this powerful ministry, I'm talking about you every single day. Fail to ignite something, man, that's a you problem. Because this gospel was not meant to be just, and you get some of the best speakers of the world in here, but it means nothing if it doesn't activate you on an everyday level. If it doesn't light a fire in you and you become Richard, and you become crazy and you become a person that's like, I believe everything and I'm going to see everything. If I gave you keys to a car and you just sat in this room and you're like, man, look at my Porsche, buddy. It was given to me. You know, for like the first week, I'd think you're cool. But after 10 years, I'd be like, bro, you've never drove your car. You're sitting in the room singing songs about your car, telling everybody that if you hit this button, it should do this. But if you've never actually done anything in the car, then what is even the point of singing about the keys? That's actually religion to me. Having a form of it, having a moment. In here, everything is blessed. In here, y'all look great. You follow what I'm saying? But in everyday life, if it's not causing you to activate the faith that's in your life and causing you to do something and stretch beyond the natural realm and allow you to be possessed with a promise so you can live every day in the supernatural, then it's not really happening for you. Because the goal of apostles and prophets and these things are equipped the saints for so we'd be equipped for the ministry God has called us to. And you say, man, well, I'm waiting for my pulpit ministry. You're gonna die waiting. You're like the meme that has the skeleton guy. You're like a skeleton sitting in this chair talking about one day I'll be released. You've been released. You just die. Seriously, I saw one of those cute things, and it was a guy waiting for the right girl. And he was a skeleton. And I texted to a single guy in our church. I'm like, this is you, you idiot. I'm like, God brought you this girl, because I try to hook you up. God brought you this one, and this is you sitting on that chair. You're going to die like that. Well, guess who's married with a kid and leading our youth ministry? Come on now. But there's a moment that, seriously, I saw a girl in that Toronto meeting. That was a student, and she came to serve, and I'm like, Ryan, I think Ryan came here. I'm like, Ryan, that's you, buddy. But look, it's you in the supernatural if you're not activated. It's you waiting for the right everything to happen. That's not how this thing works, man. Ministry isn't like, okay, you know, everything feels right. Oh, do you feel comfortable? You know, everything. Are you okay? Because it can happen right now. Dude, that's what in the world are you talking about? Some of the greatest miracles I've ever seen in my life, I didn't feel anything. I just knew what the word says, and I knew that I was in a position. And when life speaks, if you just step back a step, it's never what you think it is. It's never what you think it is. I can show you instant after instant that the world said it was this, and Jesus took a step back and was like, no. Here's the truth. And when I deal with anything in life, it's never what you tell me. I take a step back because I'm not even looking in the natural realm. And I'm saying, God, what can you speak right now that's going to change this whole circumstance? And he always does. But you've got to be trained enough to take a step back in your life and go, yeah, this has got to be activation. This has to be, it's the test of faith in your life. You know, when you... Thank God I didn't have years of school, but some of you are still students. But the truth is, you increase by passing tests, and you have exams. And the reality is, it's the same thing in the realm of faith. You have exams that God puts in front of you. You know, the Bible says if you're not faithful with little, then you can't be a ruler over much. That's not a religious term. That's saying you actually won't even have a capacity to handle what I want to give you if you're not faithful what I've told you to do. And I remember in the early days, I wanted as many exams as I could get. It didn't matter what it was. I remember I was eating at McDonald's one time, just literally. I mean, I was about to open a fresh Big Mac. My wife won't let me now, but I still would any moment. And I'll never forget, I'm sitting down. I would chuck the fries out, keep half of them in the warm incubator box. And I'm ready to eat, and I'm not even kidding, man. A van pulls up with like... all these mentally challenged people in it. I mean, they were just twisted, man. They weren't even right. And I'm trying to eat my food, and all I could see is demons on that bus laughing at me. Man, I can't live this. This life means nothing to me. Do you feel what I'm saying? Like, I wasn't made to go to Target. Like life leaves me so empty at the end of the day. And I'm sitting in this McDonald's and I'm looking out this window at these people that are like drooling on themselves and mentally, and I'm just like, it's a mockery, man. And I could see demons looking out that window laughing at my faith. And I said to my friend, I said, I'm done with this, man. This is, look, even if the gospel's real or it's not, I'm not here to, look, if this thing don't real, I'll go back to selling drugs. This isn't, I gave my life for this thing. And I just like chuck my Big Mac. You know that was the Lord. I was fed up with food for a moment. A quick moment. And I walked right up on that bus, dude. And I said to the bus driver, I said, let me tell you something. I have seen miracles by the hands of Jesus Christ. And I believe that God could heal the people on this bus. Can I please pray for them? Now, you think that's a bold move. Let me tell you something. I've said that to people a million times, maybe 200,000. Not one person ever said no. And the half a no I got was, sure, pray for me, but I really don't want to be healed because I want my disability check. And I still prayed for him, but I wanted him to drop dead. Talking like that nonsense. And I went on that bus, dude. I'm telling you, I laid my hands on every single person. And I started cursing the devil off of them. I started commanding their minds to be sound. It was a hard picking for a while. I get to the back of the bus, and I lay my hands on this one woman, and she just screams. And she says, thank you, Jesus. And she jumps up out of her seat, and she was healed. I said, listen, I was like, you know what? There's more to this. I took her hand. I'm like on a little bluebird. You follow what I'm saying? I'm walking her up and down the aisles with all the other mentally challenged people. And I'm like, more for you, more for you. And another person gets healed on this bus. I mean, legit, dude. I'm not talking about like semi. I mean, fully healed, man. This bus driver gives his life to the Lord. That business lost two people, I'll tell you what, that day. But you know something? I walked away from that, and I went back to my food. And for me, it was like, dude, it's no option for me. Like, there's not a plan B. And for me, I wanted every single faith test there was, that I would not be a mediocre Christian. And I wouldn't even consider them Christians. That I wouldn't be just some another believer that's ineffective and barren. And even now, as I preach around the world and all the things we're doing, there's no off for me. Like, I can try, but you're just burdened everywhere you go. I was at a theme park, man, yesterday. I was like, I'm trying to shut off my head because I can't look at life any other way. We go to a bunch of football games a year. Obviously not so, well, you're way behind, but we at least can get out quick. But I watch football. I remember we went to a Thursday night game with the Jets last year in New York, and we went to the game, and I'm excited, you know. I'm with ministry friends, and they're coming out with a Color Rush jersey, so I bought mine, and we're all excited. I'm in the pro shop, and my wife comes, but, you know, she's a wonderful lady, and her favorite part is the beginning, when everybody runs out, and there's fire, and the jet comes, and the bird flies, you know. So she really likes the beginning antics, and she's like, hurry up, we're going to miss the beginning. And so I'm trying to pay, but I really should have got a discount because of my season ticket, and I'm bickering, and yeah, yo, go get your manager, and this man next, and I'm really in a hurry. Everybody's waiting, people are in our seats, we're in a rush, and this man next to me is, and I couldn't be more in a hurry. And this man next to me is like, hey, and I'm like, hey, what's up? And I'm just like, let this manager come, I want my discount. His jersey was expensive. I'm like, I want my discount. You know, and the guy goes, I've been a season ticket holder since 86. And I'm like, hey, cool, man. I mean, I know I look like the stereotypical chunky New Yorker, but please don't talk to me. I'm thinking, you know what I mean? I'm so busy. I want to get to my seat. And I'm like, that's cool. You know, I've been a season ticket for a little while too. And he said, I think this is my last game. And I said, oh, great. I hope they win. I'm like turning away from the guy because I'm just thinking, I don't even know. You don't talk to me, first of all. It's weird, you creep. I'm not in San Diego, and I'm waiting for the manager, and then he goes, I have a heart condition, and my doctor said I'm going to die. And I'm like, oh, man. My back is to this guy, and I'm like, really, dude? And I'm like, if there's ever a moment that I just don't want to pray for the sick, I'm like, I got food, friends, and I'm just like, really, Lord? Like, right now? Like, my wife wants to see the jet come out with the torch. And I was just like, you know what? I turned to the guy, and I'm like, look, let me tell you something. I'm just like, forget it, devil. You want to play with me? I'll knock this guy right here in the middle of the store, okay? And I said, let me tell you something, man. I said, Jesus Christ, I'm waiting for the manager. I said, can heal you right now. I started telling testimonies about major miracles I've seen in Victoria, British Columbia. A guy just, organs grew in his heart and he got healed, and a kidney that wasn't there grew. And man, I'm starting to talk about some crazy stuff because he's telling me he has all these valves shut. And right in that store, I'm like, I'm going to pray right now that the fire of God touches your heart and that Christ can heal you. And I lay my hands, and the guy is like bawling. I mean, I'm trying to run to the kickoff. And now the manager comes, and I'm in the middle of prayer, and I'm just like, I'll pay it. Just don't worry about the discount now. I don't really care. And he got touched. I mean, just believed that God healed him, and I'm just telling him, you'll go to more games. I tell you in Jesus' name, you know, I'm trying to release the word over the guy, but there's no off. There's no life. So many people come in an atmosphere like this, and the off button comes the minute you get home or the minute you get in your worldly environment or you work or wherever you go. But that's not how this gospel was meant to be. It was meant to be an everyday moment of contending and believing and passing these faith tests, no matter what they are. They might be financial tests and belief to just give radically so and believe that God will break things open in your life. It might be a family member that, you know, it's always funny when it comes around holidays and you got to get around your crazy family, all of a sudden believers don't talk. But your drunk uncle will slam down beer and he'll start flying off the handle about nonsense, about rubbish, and Christians stay silent. Man, every single opportunity is a faith test for you. It's a faith exam to go to the next level in faith. And we have got to stop waiting it for it to be so blaringly obvious that it needs to be symbols over your head for you to finally go, oh man, I guess I'll be praying for you. Like, it has got to be on your mind, I have got to pass every faith exam. Whatever God puts in my way, he's given me the ability to overcome. Doesn't matter what it is. There's no shame. There's nothing. If it is in front of you, then he's given you the power to overcome it. It does not matter. You have a zone around, I call it the throne zone. If something enters this deal, you're done. It doesn't even matter. I don't care what it comes from, where it happens. If anything enters this zone of me and my family, it's finished. It is absolutely finished. Because I have no tolerance for anything else. If it comes in my life, God has given me the power to overcome. But it's faith exams. And I think we've set up Christianity, man, where it's like we gather around people that have passed a lot of faith exams. And sure, God gives us apostles. And sure, God puts people in our lives. But you should never be limited in what you've been given. Because you haven't been. He's given you full measure. And it's a faith exam to in your everyday life to say, man, I'm going to believe God at his word. You know, we do this big Easter outreach every year. And, you know, we'll drop 10,000 eggs and, you know, whatever we do, man. I preach the gospel and lives are getting changed. Everybody's getting set free. And I was so tired of printing off thousands of little Easter flyers and you just leaving them in your car. So this year, I changed it up on them. I'm talking about like now. I said, I'm giving you 5. And I dare, you're not getting any more. I don't care what you put in your car, you're going to be an ineffective Christian. I said, you're getting 5 each only. And you need to pray over each and every invitation. You only get 5. To believe that they're going to be seeds, that when you invite somebody and you release it, that God's going to touch them. And he's going to, why? Because you need to learn how to hear from God, man. You need to stop just handing out, putting flyers in your car, acting like you don't do anything for Christ. God's gonna bless expectation. He's going to bless what you put in front of him. You know, supernatural increases and accidental. So when you begin to get a heart and you begin to pray over these dumb flyers and you go, and all of a sudden names start popping in your head and you start putting faith attached where normally you had no faith to believe. And now people, I'm watching it, they're like, this is Mary and this is Johnny. And brother, putting faith behind a flyer because there's expectation. Because you're only getting five. And how faithful, how all I'm asking you to do is go home and pray as you look at these weird little flyers. And you ask God, who do they belong to? Because you learn to hear the voice of God. I remember running around our city. I mean, crazy stuff, man. I had a $20 bill one time. I wanted to see. I just wanted to touch somebody for Christ. I'm learning how to hear the voice of God. I just want to be effective. And I'm running around my city, and I'm just like, who do I give this $20 bill to at a gas station? And I'd pull up to a gas station, I'd scan it, and I'd be like, nope, not this one. Listen, I'm sure you were at home watching Ricky Lake, but I was trying to exercise my spiritual gifts. And I went to another gas station. I said, is it this one, Lord? See, the problem is you need to realize that he's not going to deny somebody that's willing and that has a heart yielded to the Holy Spirit. That's how you learn. God's ability to keep you is greater than the enemy's ability to deceive you. People that do miracles didn't just fall on it overnight. I know I'm giving you secrets from beyond the veil. There's work to this. And nobody knew who I was, and everybody thought I was nuts, and I might as well have been Richard. But I would drive, and I finally went to a gas station. I had a $20 bill in my pocket, and the Lord said, this one. It might have been a little creepy. It was a lady pumping gas, but I felt like I needed to give it to her. And so I ran up, and I said, listen, hey, I don't want to spook you. You don't talk to people where I come from. I said, excuse me, hey, don't really want to freak you out or nothing. I just want to tell you I was praying, and I felt like I needed to give you this. In Jesus' name, no strings attached. God loves you, and he has a plan for your life. And I'm like, here you go. And as I'm walking away, she clicks $20 on the gas. And she says, she starts weeping. She says, do you see this little girl in the back? And I see this beautiful baby. And she said, I had no food at all for her. And I didn't know what to do, and my family's not here, and I knew that I needed to get gas in this car so we could get home and I could even get to work. And I was literally asking God, if you're real, please help me in this situation. And I'm like literally running around New London with a $20 bill like I'm crazy. It's not accidental. It's as you yield yourself to the Holy Spirit, then he can move through your life. It's not like, you know, this big pounding that you think it is. It turns into that one day, but it's you learning to hear the voice of God. You learning to stretch out your faith. You learning to be vocal. You learning to believe God and see this thing come to pass. You follow what I'm saying? It's like I had nothing. I had nothing. There's no plan B in my life. I don't have an education to fall back on. I don't have a reputation to save. If this wasn't my life, there'd be nothing else. You'd see me in some city doing the same thing I'm doing now. There wasn't, you know, it's not like I came from this family that was successful. But I've learned how to tap into the realms of God. I've learned how to exercise my faith to a place where you believe for greater things. David even said, it was the bear and the lion, and it helped me face Goliath. We need to stop trying to jump to Goliath when we're not even slinging a stone in our everyday life. And you build faith. It's true. I had faith for people that had car accidents because I saw so many people healed. I had faith for deaf ears because I've seen so many healed. But it was after the first few that I saw, man, I know this thing. I know what it feels like to see release in somebody. And I had faith there. It's hard to explain. But it was like you could line up sickness. And I'd build a confidence because I've prayed for this so many times. Property, forget it. I have so much faith for property. because God's given it to us. And I know how to put my hands on a building and call it in, and it comes. I know how to look at property overseas, and God just gives it to us. That didn't just happen. It was renting a space and believing God for to increase, and then he gave me the whole space, and then it was believing God for, and it was every step of the way. I mean, I literally was in downtown San Diego this morning, this gnarly, crazy building, man, that Amy Simple McPherson owned. And Smith Wigglesworth preached in. It's like he barely preached in America. But this crazy building, I don't even know where it is. It's just planes are like almost hitting it every single second. And it's this, and the thing is like for startup businesses now. What a mockery of the cross. And we have pastor or ministry friends in the area, and they're like, dude, let's go get this building, man. Man, I'm laying hands on this property downtown because these things need to come back to the kingdom. It's a mockery, man. These properties that were set apart by God are filled with businesses, and there's crosses all outside of it because you can't take it off the wall. And there were more miracle meetings in this building. I'm talking about San Diego. It was near Balboa Park. In San Diego, dude. But everybody just walks around like God's not there anymore. And everybody's consumed with their own affairs. And somehow, like, we're okay looking back on the 40s and the miracle revivals in San Diego. And I'm like, if somebody doesn't get hungry to pull that back into today, if somebody doesn't get desperate to do that, then how's it going to happen? And I'm out of my mind screaming in the middle of San Diego, having visions and visitations, because I see God redeeming these things again. But everything is connected to you. When I sat down in the lawyer office last year or a couple of years ago, and I'm you know, we buy this massive awakening place. It's 280 years old, and they couldn't even find the title because there was none. They're going through the city hall, and they're like, there's no deed. We don't even know how to do this because the building was there before the whole city was established. In this city that was like, you know, New London was established like 1630. And they're like, what do we do? We've never ran into this before. This is pretty crazy. And they're digging in the basement, and they call them crypts. They're digging in the crypts of these buildings, and they finally found one piece of paper. Like dated, like, I put it on my Instagram, it was like dated like the 1700s or something. And this guy was like, I, Sam, give X property to the first ecclesiastical society like 2 years after Jesus died. You know what I mean? And there's no title, there's no deed, it's just like this piece of paper. And as I'm sitting there about to sign the papers, it hits me that this is the first time this property has changed hands in 280 years. A building that has seen awakening and revival. I got the record books, man. People stood up in that meeting when they would preach, and one guy cursed God in the meeting and ran out the door, and a lightning bolt killed him right in front of our church. Yeah, I dare you to be dishonest now. I mean, crazy stuff, dude. And I'm signing the documents, and it just hits me. When God speaks a promise, when he brings awakening, when he sends people to build our building, okay? He has you in mind. That there's a moment when it comes to the plan of God being fulfilled. On the day of Acts, he had you in mind. When Whitfield was preaching in these buildings that I'm in, I'm not even a forethought of anything. And he had me in mind. When I would drive over that bridge to New London, because I lived on the other side of the ghetto, I remember driving over the bridge to go to New London at 6 years old. That building has already been there long before then. At 5 years old, walking by that building to go to, they have a big sail fest down by the pier where our building is now. Man, I'm 5 years old and my mother's walking me through sail fest and that building was still there. And here I am 5 years old and God's like, he's the guy. I'm five. I never even knew the Lord until I was like 18. And God's like, he's the one. I'm going to raise you up to take that baton from Whitfield and the forefathers in Jesus and do everything that I've called you to do. But it doesn't just happen. But he predestined you that you would be the firstborn among many brothers. Act like it. That you would be the head and not the tail. And I'm convinced buildings go unoccupied because believers won't believe. Sickness remains on the earth because believers won't declare. The Bible says many of them are enslaved and nobody will say deliver and nobody will say restore. That's your job. You're on this earth to solve the demon problem. I remember the oil spill happened, you know, that BP oil spill, and I had friends in Alabama, and it was so, you know, it was pretty destructive, man. Oil's coming out of the ground, everything's dying, the animals, see, I do care. The animals are dying. This oil, nobody knows how to stop the leak, and I'm just sitting there in prayer, and I'm like, dude, why aren't the believers telling the government how to stop the leak? Like, if we really think that God is that strong, then why aren't we trying to believe? And I called a friend of mine, a prophet friend of mine down in Alabama, and I said, PK, listen, man, here's what God is putting on my, I'm walking on the beach in Rhode Island, which I mean, no oil will ever get up there, but I'm burdened for this oil spill because we should know the truth. And I called him and I said, the believers are the one that should tell the code on how to plug this thing. And he said, you know, I'm walking the beach right now, looking at the oil spill, asking God for the solution. Let me tell you something. That's the heart that God can respond to. Somebody that will just, you know, my God, the Bible says, ask of me and I'll give you the nations as your inheritance. But how many really ask for nations? I mean, think about it, man. Who is literally saying, I want a whole nation? You know what I mean? Okay, I don't need a show of hands, but you all are amazing. But think about that, man. Jesus said we don't even have it because we won't believe for it. But you know, it's exceedingly abundantly above all that you could ever ask, think, or imagine. Like, take as much as you can believe for and double it. And it's like we can be that audacious in life. Audacious enough that God would put these properties back in the hands of the Holy Spirit believers. And if I can believe for that awakening building to be given to me. I had a dream that God, you know, here's this $3.5 million property, and I had a dream one night, and the Lord said, I'm giving you a house that was in foreclosure by the water. And I'm like, okay. And God said, you're not going to pay any more than $250,000 for it. I said, I thought it was for us. I'm like, hey, Lord's going to give us a house, babe. You know what I mean? And all of a sudden, we're in this building renting, and I don't know, running water. I mean, the thing was falling apart. And I'm like, well, what about this? And there's no air conditioning in our building. And it does get hot, trust me. And I'm like, there's some issue. We need a couple things done. And the people that own the building were like, we don't have the money. We don't need those things. I'm like, well, and they're like, well, you can put the money into it. I'm like, no, what do you mean? I don't own the building. And so I scheduled a meeting with them. And I said, I want you to sell us the building. And they, you know, they got all weird and wanted to get all stiffed up. And they were like, well, what is the value? And this one's asking $1 million down the road. And I said, let me tell you the value. The value is this. God gave me a dream. Listen to me. I'm going to pray tonight because God is going to give you a gift of supernatural courage. You listen to me. I'm telling you, I felt it so strong tonight. I looked at these people and I said, I'm going to tell you what's going to happen. I said, I had a dream from the Holy Spirit that this property was given to me because it's in foreclosure. And I am not to pay you a dime over $250,000. And I said, and you're going to be the bank. And I said, let me tell you something. This, you don't have time to think about this because you need to ask yourself this. Whoever in your lifetime is going to come here at whatever I was, 35 years old, and going to care this much about this old building? Listen, I'm not in San Diego with young people acting like a fool. I'm in New England with old people drooling. Do you understand me? So not in your lifetime. I mean, and there's one moment, this woman in the meeting was like, I don't care, do whatever you want to do. I won't be here next year. She wasn't saying she was leaving the church. She was saying she's going to die. Like, this is where these people are. And they're like, all right, we'll do it. Let me tell you something, that don't just happen. Do you understand what I'm telling you? Like, you can't just go make that happen if you tried. If you had $1 million, you couldn't make that happen. That's because you have faith and courage. That's because you can stand up when God puts something in your heart and he puts that word in you, that you can go to situations in life and say, you know something? You know, if someone in the Bible can command the sun to stand still, I mean, you want to talk about faith, bro? Like, they're fighting and running and the night's falling. I don't know about you. Ain't nobody trying to be in a war at night. They didn't have the iPhone, and if you hold your hand on it, you can pick your brightness level of your flashlight. And he needed the Lord to hold the sun still for them to get out and to overcome. And if you can have that kind of faith, to command the sun to stand still, then what in the world's inside of you?
Come on.
What can you believe for? What cure, what can you have audacious faith to begin to believe for in your life? Wow, this is a spontaneous platform. Everything I said, I wanted to say, I didn't. Praise the Lord. But God wants to equip you tonight. You know, in Acts 17, the Bible says that Paul was provoked when he saw that the city was given into idols. You know, so many people live unprovoked today. Acts 17, 16. So many people live unprovoked today. You know, I remember reading the Book of Awakenings at our church, and right before the chapter on the Great Awakening, this author penned this. I had to write it down. They wrote, 1799 was the winter of our discontent. And that was right before this second great awakening would sweep through our region. But it literally was believers going, yeah, this was the winter we were fed up. That we were discontent with life as we knew it. That it just left us empty every time, and we got serious about the things of God. Praying and believing and worshiping and going after the things that God had for us. What's the opposite of living provoked? Delayed and busy, not effective. You know, in John chapter 4, Jesus has this encounter with the woman at the well, and she shows up, you know, and they're talking and talking, and she didn't really have a clue, but the Bible says that the disciples went out to get Jesus food. Crazy. I mean, if you want to do something nice for me, go get me food. I'm kidding. Jesus, they went to get Jesus food. And they come back, and they're just kind of like, why are you talking to this woman? And Jesus is like, they're like, aren't you hungry? And he's like, the food I eat, you know nothing about, Jesus said to them. And they're kind of like, well, did you already eat? What happened? You know, because here Jesus is talking to this woman. And I'm talking about the disciples. Sometimes the people closest to Jesus were the most clueless. They went out to get a sandwich that Jesus didn't order. Sometimes you can be busy around the things of God, but completely ineffective. Because you're not even close to what God has on his heart. And they brought him this food, and he's like, this isn't even what I want. And he says something so powerful in verse 35 of John 4. He says, stop saying that there's 4 more months and then comes the harvest. Behold, I tell you, lift up your eyes and look at the fields, because they're already white for harvest. What is he telling them? Stop living your life as if you have time. The Bible says in the book of Ephesians, redeem the time because the days are evil. So Jesus is telling the disciples, stop living every day as if you have time. And somehow as believers, we tend to live as if it's 4 more months. well, something's coming, or, you know, well, 4 more months, or, you know, you live a delayed life, and Jesus is like, open your eyes. Because the fields are white for harvest. It's not another era, it's now. Look, I don't think some deliverer's going to come into San Diego on a white horse, dude. I think it's y'all folks, man, to be honest with you. This is it, bro. This is the bunch right here. This is it. You're the awakeners for San Diego. You're the ones that are going to carry the fire of God to shake this land. You're the ones that are taking the torch from Jesus and Amy Simple McPherson and all the radical awakeners that were in this land. It has been touched by the power of God. I mean, it is today, but guys, it's going to go so much further than just this house. And this house is expanding in radical ways, but it's you taking the fire and everything that God has given you and producing in you a supernatural courage where you can stand in situations and declare God's word and seem out of your ever-loving mind. But God's with you. Just crazy stuff, man. I mean, just nuts faith. Like you're out of your mind faith. Like believing for things that you're just crazy about. That's what causes the sun to stand still. That's what causes faith to rise in your heart and to begin to stand for stuff that most people wouldn't even dare to dream for. You know how many ambulances I've chased to try to pray for dead people? You know how many funerals I've invaded? Because I just want to give God a chance. Every time somebody dies, it's like no funeral talk with me. I'm like immediately calculating your age and figuring out if I want you to live. You know what I mean? Like, if you're like 80, I might just pass. You know what I mean? Like, oh, bless Betsy. But I'm saying, if I feel like there's still something left in the tank, bro, I'm after it, man. I don't even care. There's no apologies. I would rather die trying everything I knew that God said I could do and it not work than ever just sit in a meeting and say amen and do nothing with my life. I mean, I'll be that guy any day of the week. I was in this religious, what started the ministry for me, one of the earmarked moments is I was in a prayer, Tuesday morning prayer meeting at this dead church I got, you know, I was in, and the pastor says to me, he's like, the sanctuary, he goes, there's more people down there that have the call of God on their life, and they're just sitting in this church doing nothing with it. I didn't even know I had the call of God. I was just like, oh, man, that's not going to be me. It will never be said about me. That's what I told myself. I was young. I was like 18. I said, it will never be said about me that I have the call of God on my life and I'm sitting in a meeting, that I should be doing something for heaven. And so I just thought I might as well just give it all, fall on my face, dying, trying to go for my dream than ever anybody ever tell me that I'm sitting in a seat when I know I should be doing something else with my life. Because the truth is, provision and all the protect, you know, there was a time we were living, not a time, but 2 years ago, we were living in one of the worst streets in New London. It's called Bank Street. It's where the drug addicts and the, you know, ladies that sell themselves and all this stuff goes on. And I mean, if you would even come to my house, we got broken into how many times? I came home from a trip. I had like a $10,000 wedding ring stolen. People broke in. If you don't lock stuff, it's over, man. I had a guy helping me with my luggage. He didn't lock my door. We got robbed. I lost everything. Whatever. How many people walked out of my house and people would put guns in their faces and just, I'll kill you and just, welcome to my house. Come over. But, you know, people rise up with fear masked as wisdom. And they say things to me like, oh, you're putting your family in danger. Somebody said that to me. Man, stupid people. Oh, you're putting your, how would you ever put your family there? And you guys are living here on this worst street and why would you ever do this and da, da, da. And I'm like, look, let me tell you something. the safest place to be on the planet is where God has you. Do you understand what I'm saying? This isn't an earthly thing you figure out in your head. That's what gets you killed. I said, if God called me to this little crack street, then it's I'll sit out here with my family all night long and won't get touched. The goal of life isn't to play it safe by your own standards. The goal of life is to be exactly where he's called you to be. That's the safest place, and that's where the most provision will be, and that's where that open heaven atmosphere that's always available will be, and that's when the blessings of God flow. You can be in a beautiful place that you've padded yourself. It's going to come crumbling down. It will not work for you. Because where you need to be is where God has placed you. And there's no fear in that. And if it's a bush in Zambia, then you better go there now. And if it's a crack street in Connecticut, you can come home with me tomorrow morning. And I don't live there now, I don't look back and think it was an issue. We've got to get out of this head whatever we think the abundant life is in the natural means, because that's not it. Most people's lives don't want anything to do with it because it's not, I need to be right where God has called me to be. You need to be right where God's called you to be. Without options. Without plan Bs. You know, when I got into the ministry, my wife was praying one day and the Lord told her a promise. He said, if you take care of my house, I'm going to take care of yours. That was it. That's all I needed to hear. Everything I would do would be for souls. Everything I would do would be to feed the poor. I wasn't concerned about myself. We live today as if we're just so concerned about ourselves. You're going to die empty. This earth means nothing. If all of you die in a moment, what does it even matter? Who cares how much money you have? Nobody cares about you. Nothing matters. You can't take anything to heaven with you. Nothing. That's why Jesus said, store up for yourselves treasures in heaven. My life mandate is to have more in my bank account in heaven than I do ever on this earth. That more would be invested in the realm that I don't see that would ever be on this earth here. We're way too attached to this place. Way too attached. And then when sickness comes up, we give it too much attention. And when they say your daughter's not going to live, we give it too much attention. Instead of standing on his word and saying, absolutely not. That's not the heaven I live in. That isn't my reality. It's the world's reality. My reality doesn't have poverty in it. My reality doesn't exist with addiction and disease. My reality is a completely different reality. But if we tolerate anything, it's done. I mean, you're gonna live a cracked life. It's those kingdom priorities that allow courage to rise up in you and do things that you wouldn't normally do and believe for things that you wouldn't normally have. That's where you begin to unlock the mysteries of the kingdom. And it doesn't matter how long. I mean, Smith Wigglesworth was like 46, almost 50 years old. And he just went after the baptism of the Spirit to have power. And, you know, now he's known as the apostle of faith. But it's a moment. It's a yielding. It's a giving your all. It's an eyes opening, believing what you've been given. It's the only way to live this life in God. And that life will be abundant for you. God calls us. He tells you where he plants you. You know, I'm my Lord. There's like a little town with like 9,000 people in Nova Scotia called New Glasgow. I bet nobody's ever been there. My wife, I'm so sorry. There's nothing there, but God has called me there. I'm done joking, but I like a lot of these people tell me it's like my Africa. I don't know what to tell them. It's the most barren place to me, but God has called me there. And when you are called somewhere, you then begin to see it differently. So when I go there, I start like weeping because of hope. And I start seeing a little fishing village that needs to be set on fire for God. I mean, none of you have been there. No pride will ever be there. But I'm purchasing land there. Why? Because my heart burns for the places God has called me to go. When you're called somewhere, you know, my friend in New Glasgow, his name's John Linthorne. He's our pastor there. You know, I mean, gosh, I mean, if you went there, you're never going to spend vacation there. But he would say things to me like Pictou County pizza. I'm like, bro, no one cares. Nobody knows, and your food's horrible. And you would like try to tell me it's world renowned. I'm like, bro, your food sucks. Like, nobody likes it. No one even knows that you exist on the earth. Do you understand me? And I flew him out to Vancouver, which is beautiful, where my wife's from. And he likes hockey because he's Canadian. We went to a hockey game. And I'm showing him Vancouver. It's like mountains, ocean, like all touching and kissing. I mean, it's stunning. And he's driving around Vancouver going, oh, yeah, this reminds me of New Glasgow. I'm like, bro, you're a fool, okay? Don't you put down my wife's birthplace like this. And I just like, you're delusional, man. You are, I fly you out, you're delusional. There's nothing that looks like New Glasgow. Maybe Fraggle Rock, the trash heap lady. Nothing else. And it would always bother me. And I'm like, why does John Linthorne think that this is so beautiful? Like, he is sick. Like, all the young people are moving out. I'm just like, what are you doing? And one day, man, I'm getting ready for the day, and the Lord just was like, because he's called there. And I was like, wow. Because when God puts something in you, you start to develop an unquenching love for that place. My wife almost moved here, no secret. Probably the lowest point of her life. I'm glad she didn't. I had to meet her. Was getting denied at the border with her car packed, ready to move here. It's like heaven to her. Glad she's with me now. But, you know, we were at SeaWorld yesterday, and it's like, you know, it's flashy. It's San Diego, man. It's like whales. And like, I started acting weird, man. I was just like, the Mystic Aquarium has penguins. Like, you don't even know what I'm talking about, dude. My dumb aquarium. And you know, they wanted to go look at the belugas. And I'm like, well, our aquarium has belugas, and it's just like this. And I just stopped, and I was like, uh-oh. I said, Deb, am I John Linthorne? Like, I'm in San Diego, California, dude, at SeaWorld, trying to pimp my Mystic Aquarium, which we've never, my wife won't even take me. In every exhibit, I couldn't even enjoy. My wife's like just glistening and pumped. And I'm just like, the Mystic Aquarium has this. And I actually had to stop. And I was like, I'm John Linthorne. I literally am John Linthorne in Vancouver talking about New Glasgow looks like this. But as foolish as I sounded, I realized I was called there. I realized that when I went to bed and I realized that I was so dumb saying these things, it's because I so burned for my area in New England. That you see things the way God does when you're burdened by his purposes. You know, the Bible says in the book of Psalms, it's a weird little phrase, and it says something like, the satisfied soul loathes the honeycomb, but to the bitter soul, everything becomes sweet. Or something like that. Maybe I mixed it up. But my point is, when you're hungry for something, it doesn't take much effort. Every little thing can, every bitter thing becomes sweet to those that are hungry. But if you're already full, then you don't even have any burden and you don't recognize anything. What am I saying? You've got to learn to see heaven the way God's wired you to be. You've got to find the people group that you're burdened for. You need to tap into that realm on who is it you're called to reach? Where do they exist here? What regions in this land? How, you know, where is it? And San Diego's crazy big, the county, man. You got lumberjack old people in the mountains. You got surfers. You got crazies. I mean, find somebody. And just give your life to seeing something changed. Because then it goes beyond just the surface. It goes into a point where you're just like, I can't even sleep because I know I have to do this for God. And in your own backyard is unreached people groups. And in your own backyard is cultures that need to be absolutely shaken by the power of God. And he's equipping you to make that difference. He's equipping you to do that. God is going to provoke you. He's going to stir your heart for greatness. He's going to stir your heart for more. We have to be we have to be provoked by the unseen realm. You know, I was thinking about, I was telling you about Genesis 28 in verse 16 about Jacob in the gate of heaven. In Genesis 28, verse 16, it says, Jacob awoke from his place of sleep and he said, surely the Lord is in this place and I did not know it. And he was afraid and he said, how awesome is this place? This is none other than the house of God in the very gate of heaven. You need to understand something, that he didn't even recognize that that God was in that place before. He said, I did not know it. The hunger changes your perception. When you're hungry for something, you begin to recognize things that you didn't before. It helps you, it helps your view, it helps your perception. When you begin to get desperate for something, you see it in a different light. And the absence of hunger dials down expectation. When you're not hungry for the things of God and that thirst isn't there, your expectation level's like low. And your fruit level will be also. You're never going to find anything in the kingdom that you're not hungry for. It will not exist. The Bible says, eagerly desire the spiritual gifts. Pursue the gift of prophecy. If there's not a drive in you for these things, it will not come to you. It does not happen. Nobody wakes up and is accidentally hungry for the supernatural. It is something that you get hungry for, that you reach out to go after. It's not going to come by accident. You know, I find it so interesting in the Bible. It's like, you know, the prostitute and the tax collector recognized Jesus. But the religious leaders didn't have a clue who he was. Why? Why was it that the people that served their religion and the Pharisees and the Sadducees and the, you know, wouldn't sees and couldn't sees, they couldn't recognize Jesus, but it was always the prostitute or the tax collector that recognized him? It's because they were simply satisfied with religious rhetoric. Their religious rhetoric blinded them from seeing Christ for who he was. We can't live satisfied. We have to stop striving to obtain something that we already have. It's our eyes being open to what we've been given, what we possess, so we can be able to step into that. It's learning every day when these faith, you know, exams come our way that we can overcome, when the love tests come. And we got some crazy people in the church, and they're probably watching, so I'm not going to call them out, but I mean some nuts dudes. And these people come in the church, and I love it because it ruffles all the feathers of everybody else. I mean, these guys are nuts, but it makes everybody uncomfortable and everybody offended. And I'm just like, I love this guy because he's exposing all your issues. Because you don't even know how to handle yourself when there's somebody that you just don't like. I'm like, I pray more of these people in so you guys can either get run out or change. Comfort is a cancer to Christianity. We have to live and move and have our being in God. And so we're not moved by anything else on this earth but what moves God's hands and what he's burdened with. That's the most important thing in this life, is his agenda. You know, Mark chapter 8, I was thinking of this tonight. You know, it's courage. It's having our minds renewed. It's living in the place that God has called us to live. In Mark chapter 8, verse 31, it says, he began to teach them that the Son of Man must suffer all these things and be rejected by the chief priests and the scribes. He'll need to be killed. And he spoke this word openly, and then Peter looked at him and began to rebuke him. So here's how this works. Jesus is telling the disciples, I know you love me. I know I walk with you. I know I did miracles. But I got to tell you the truth. I'm going to die and I'm going to be raised from the dead. And Peter rises up and he goes, absolutely not, God. It'll not happen to you. I rebuke you by saying that. Let me tell you something, dude. If he did that, you would have been like, wow, that's powerful, Peter. Bravo to you, man. Wow. That's how I feel. Think about it, man. Your flesh, you think that's noble. You think somehow he's standing to help Christ. And Jesus responds to him. Oh boy, does he. And he says to Peter, get behind me, Satan. Now let me just tell you how you argue with your wife properly. If you said to your wife, look, babe, you're acting crazy. That's different than saying, girl, you're crazy. Do you understand? If you throw acting in there, it softens the blow. Baby, you acting crazy, girl. Come on. You know what I mean? It's like, okay, maybe I'm acting. But if I was like, girl, you're nuts. You're crazy. Then, that's like accusation. So if you want to say something bad to your spouse, don't ever. But if you throw acting in there, it just softens the blow. Man, you acting controlling, girl. Man, you're controlling. You know what I mean? Completely different. Jesus doesn't say, come on, Petey, you acting like the devil. You know what I mean? No. Dude, listen, I wish. This dude said, get behind me, you're Satan. Now, let me tell you something. There's only one of that guy. Do you understand? It's not like all of you can be Satan. There's one devil in all the little demons. He didn't even say you acting like a demon. He said, you get behind me, the main problem. You know what I mean? You are, there's only one on the earth, and he called him the one. I mean, that is like, that is the biggest insult in relational arguments. You couldn't even soften the blow. Gee, he said, and side note, a minute ago, you were cheering Peter on, so let's just back up fully. You're cheering Peter on a minute ago, and then Jesus is like, get behind me, you're the Satan. And you all of a sudden be like, oh, that's right, he's wrong. So you don't even know what you think in this conversation, to be honest with you. And Jesus calls Peter Satan. I mean, what? You could not say a worse thing on the planet. You've walked with us for 3 years and taught us to defeat the devil and how all these, and you now just call Peter him. Like he literally called him the fallen angel that was in heaven that fell. Like you are the, like bro, you just referred to him as the worst guy on the planet. Like you can't get worse than the Satan. Like not a relative, not an offshoot. You're it. Get behind me, Satan. I mean, I would have been like, dang. I would have like turned my head and started laughing. Like, bro, that's rough. I honestly would have been like, what did he say? It's so bad. Here's what he said. Get behind me, Satan. For you are not mindful of the things of God, but the things of men. What? So if you're a believer that's mindful of the things of men over God, I just might as well call you Satan. That's intense. See, there's perspective in bearing Christianity, and then there's kingdom perspective. In bearing Christianity, you might think that Peter was noble, but in a Christian perspective, no, we don't stop the plan of God. He was telling you that it was prophesied that he was sent to die. Don't you stop my plan on this earth. If his plan on this earth is for souls and signs and wonders and revival, then don't ever step in the way of that. We cannot be mindful of the things of men. We must allow courage to rise up and not just go with what everybody else is saying. Imagine in this story if it was like, no, Jesus, you will not die. And another disciple was like, shut up, Peter. This is what the plan of God was from the beginning. We're going to yield to that. That would have been an awesome story. Because I just would have went around telling everybody, shut up, like the Bible said. You know what I mean? That was a joke, and it's clearly getting late. My latte friends. We've got to allow faith and courage to rise up inside of us. it's important. You know, we see, it's interesting because there's like, in our church, you see these young people, and they're catching the fire of God as teenagers. They're believing God in his word, you know, and it's like they got their whole life in front of them. And so it's almost like it's an etch-a-sketch, you know what I mean? Like whatever you want to draw on the canvas of life is yours. Dream. And these kids are like, I'll take nations, I'm going to do this, I'm going to invade this culture, I'm going to, and it's like, it's so beautiful to see because there's not like killed dreams. Do you know what I mean? And then when you're in your 20s, still a little fresh, right? Still a little dreamy dream. Then you get in your 30s and you're like, okay, what do I really believe? Then you get in your 40s and your 50s and you're like, maybe I didn't believe. And then by the time you're like elderly, which, I mean, it don't matter what age, 60s, 70s, 80s, and 90s, you get retirement age. Look, the older you get, the more you have to risk. I see people all the time. Oh, when I retire, I'm going to do this. Or when I just get at this stage in my life. It never, ever comes ever. And you work your whole life slaving for the world system. You get yourself a house. You pay it off. Who cares? Nobody's impressed by you. You put money in the bank. Still nobody cares. It means nothing to heaven. And then what? You retire, you have a bad hip and an AARP card, and you're doing nothing with your life. If you're not giving it all now, you sure ain't going to do it down the road. If you're not living every day now with the faith test, it's not going to change because something happens. Bible says I give seed to the sower. I remember reading that one day, and I was like, man, God, if you put seed in my hand, I'm just going to throw it all over the heart. And the Lord was like, no, I give seed to the sower. And I'm like, I know, fill up my bag. Dude, we're going to make this happen. He said, no, I give seed to the sower. And it's like, what came first, the seed or the sower? It was the sower that mattered, not the seed. His seed just always comes. But I give it to the heart that sows. And I realized a long time ago, it's not, seed means nothing. Money means nothing. That's all a byproduct of kingdom. So if I'm a sower and a giver and I give my life and I lay my hands on the sick and I do everything God's called me, the finances is the last thing I'll worry about because he gives seed to the sower. Jesus was in a boat with a bunch of people and he said, listen, get in the boat. We're going to go to the other side. They're excited. They get in the boat and they go to the other side. All of a sudden the winds and waves kick in. Remember, they're scared. Jesus leaving at the back of the boat and they're like, why are you trying to kill us? How fickle is that? Dude, they're taking Instagram photos an hour before, talking about, I'm about to get on this boat. You're the coolest person. An hour later, you're asking Jesus, why is he trying to kill you? He rebukes the storm, right? And really, the only thing he did is his inside reality became the external one. That's all it was. He rebukes the storm. The winds and the waves cease. Here's the problem with that whole story. If I would bring in Peter tonight to testify, hey, we're going to have testimony time. Everybody clap your hands for Peter, whatever your last name is. Okay, stop. So he gets up here and he's like, hey, guys, I got to tell you a story, real testimony. And you're like, oh, man, great, Peter. And he's like, you know, we got in this boat with Jesus. And you're like, wow. And he said, we're going to the other side. You know, man, we knew we were going here. It was really cool, guys. And listen, we got in the boat and then, you know, man, the winds and waves start coming. We thought we were dying, and you're going to be like, wow. And then Peter's like, I didn't know what to do, you know. So we went to the back of the boat, and we just started asking God to help us. And you know what he did? And you're like, what? And he came, and he looked at the storm, and he just said, just cease. And the storm stopped. And you'd be like, rah! And you know what you would call that, dude? Answer prayer. And Peter would have put the microphone down, and after the meeting, you would have been like, Peter, thank you so much for sharing that story. I needed that tonight. I really needed that. Thank you, Peter. Your testimony just really touched my heart. There's some storms I'm facing, and just to know I can pray, count on Jesus means so much to me, you know? So you would have been cheering Peter on. You would have thought, you know what, because you call that answered prayer. You think it's so noble that he cried and Jesus answered his prayer. But you know what Christ said to him? Where is your faith? Bro, a minute ago you just hugged this guy and told him that it meant so much to you. That's the difference between the Christian mind of men and how God views life. Why? Listen to me carefully. Because there are times that God is not concerned about doing things for you, but through you. So when he's equipped you to speak to the storm, and you go to Jesus scared that he's trying to kill you, and Jesus bails you out, that's not answered prayer. It's you needing to learn. You know what that story should have went? Somebody rose up on that boat and said, no, Jesus is in this thing, man. I curse this storm. You realize that, right? Doesn't mean just because the Bible, you know, just because the story ended up bad doesn't mean it was supposed to. Jesus is telling them, where is your faith? How is it you have no faith? How is it that I've imparted inside of you and I'm in the boat? I'm sleeping. Which, side note, you'll never overcome a struggle that you can't sleep through. He's sleeping. It's rest. And the people are running around who were excited that he was going on the journey with them, and now they said, why are you trying to kill us? Why? Because Jesus said, look, you have faith. How is it that you're in a situation in life and you have not activated what I've given you? Man, that's most of the church today in America, man. How is it that you're not active? Where is it? You tell me where it is. How is it that you're not activating it on an everyday level of your life? How is it that you're not provoked enough for you to step out every single day and begin to believe God and his word? And just seem crazy, man. You know, I had somebody in the church come up one time and they're like, you know, well, pastor, you know, remember God gave me this word and he gave me, and I'm like, yeah, I get it, man. And he's like, well, I'm really upset, you know? And I'm like, why? He's like, well, because, you know, you haven't really released me yet. And I'm like, what? I think I said something like, bro, shut up. You can't pay your electric bill. I think I said something to him like that. I'm like, bro, you really think you're going to go to the nations and you can't pay your electric bill? And I brought him outside the office. And I looked at the city and I said, what do you see right now? And he's like, well, you know, just see buildings. I'm like, no, we got to go a little deeper. Well, I see cars. I said, no, there's, you know, maybe let's try things that have blood. And he's like, well, I see people. I said, haha, we're getting closer. And there's a hospital there. I said, here's the problem. When have I ever told you, John, don't you ever go out there and touch anybody's life? When have I ever told you, don't go lay hands on the sick? Don't go. No, I never said those things. I mean, that's the point. But somehow he thought that his promises were linked up with me doing something for him. What in the world are you talking about? I'm not like a genie for you. Like, I can't give you more than he's given you. You have got to believe. Church, you need to believe that all the words you've heard in this place, all the impartation that you've received, is activating you for such a time as this. How many people are in San Diego? 3 million. Over. Come on, dude. I give you full permission. Make a difference. 3 million people, man. That's like the whole state of Connecticut. Go make a difference. Nobody's stopping you from doing anything. Go find a life. Go find a people group. Go find someone and just wreck them. That's what you're on this earth for. Your job is secondary. Your family is even secondary. I know you don't want to hear that craziness. You understand me? That's what we live for, man. You realize how I saw all these young women in the church. I say, you've allowed your kids to be an idol for you. You need to show them the things of God. My kids are not mine. Do you understand this? They're just loaned to me. It was me and her before we chose these ones. Do you understand me? And they're in my life for a short season. to train them up in the things of God, to release them in the things of God. That's it. They're not mine. I'm not going to act like I own them then. They're on loan from heaven. I know you don't want to hear that stuff because you want your family to be an idol and you give so much power to them. No, absolutely not. The things of God are what we live for. And I'm not talking, you know, the problem is some of you live too many years on earth. I don't put my family aside for that. We do everything together as a family. I don't travel without my family, so don't be weird. But they're not, my kids are not more important than what God's plan is for us. They're in that plan. I train them in that plan. So when things happen in your family, you give away too much power, man. Your sister doesn't have any power. You understand me? Your aunt has no power. People rise up. It's like, who are you? You who, like, literally, who are you? Like, you have no power at all. It amazes me the authority you give people. Somebody can get you off rocker. Somebody says something. It's like you give it attention. I'm thinking, wow, the devil's pretty powerful, man. He don't even have to try for some of you. Some of you trying to fight devils that don't even exist anymore. Like, they've already moved on to something else, and you're still fighting something that is not even there. It's not worth it. Nothing's worth it. It's kingdom courage. It's kingdom purpose. It's what he's called us to do and what he's burned in us to do on this earth. That's all we live for, finding that eternal purpose. Yes, we pay bills. Yes, we work. Yes, we have a life. But, man, that's all to serve the purposes of God for our generation. You know, in Acts 13, it said when David died, he fulfilled God's purpose for his generation. That means there was nothing else he could have done on earth. Nothing. There wasn't another psalm. There wasn't another. Enough. It was everything he was supposed to do on this earth, he did. That's no different than us. When we die, we should do everything that God has called us to do on this earth. That's all we exist for. That means there's not another person you could pray for. There's not another service to attend. Every single thing he said that we were supposed to do, we accomplished on the earth. That's God's plan. And I feel courage tonight. I feel God stirring you for a major breakthrough in your life. You guys can come up to play for a few if you can. You know, I want to do something a little different tonight. I remember I was in Brooklyn, New York at a big church. Actually, I proposed to my wife that weekend. It was fun. I faked like I had a prophetic word. It's so bad. I was like, God's really speaking to me. God, and the whole church was like, it was like 900 people. They were like, oh, I'm like, guys, I have the word of the Lord. And they're like, what? And I called my wife up and I proposed. Faked them all out, man. Pulled a switcheroo. I'm not even sure she said yes, actually. I think it was just, we just like hugged and made it happen, but clearly she said yes at some point. It's like our 9-year anniversary today, so come on. Yeah, it is. But I remember I was preaching and I was so fed up with meetings where people didn't activate what they had inside of them. And I remember I was preaching on souls and just divine appointments and, you know, bringing the unseen realm to earth. And I was like, I feel like God's going to give an anointing for just breakthrough. Like souls being saved and lives being set free through your hands and your mouth. And I was like, if you want that impartation, come forward. And of course, the whole place ran front. And I felt like I made a mistake, man. I'm like, oh, I did something wrong. So I was like, stop the music. I was like, everybody go back to your seat. I mean, it was so awkward. It like killed the meeting. You know what I mean? It was like, I was just like, I don't care. Go sit down. We're not done with this altar call. We need to start over. We need to reset. So they get back. And then I said, okay, here's the real altar call. And I'm sorry for not saying it to you. I said, I want to pray for those that within 24 to 48 hours will walk out of this place with their eyes wide open for an opportunity. I said, if you want that impartation, then you come forward. The first one, all 800. The second one, 100 people. You know how much time I could save at the altar if I just did that every service? Like, if you're not serious, stay in your seat. Make my life a lot easier, man. I've wasted a lot of breath on breathless Christians, man. And you know what? Within 24 to 48 hours, we had so many miracles, so many testimonies. People just couldn't believe it. I mean, mailmen getting delivered, family members calling. I mean, seriously. Because when your eyes are open, things change. You know, I drive a Jeep Wrangler, and I just love the thing. A friend of mine got one, and I was like, babe, I really want one. And she's like, no. And I'm like, God's going to give me one. And sure enough, he did. A person was like, I want to give you a Jeep. So he did. And then it was a two-door, and I traded in for another one. It was stick shift. That's a whole nother thing. I didn't know how to drive it. I'm never going to do that again. And then I traded that in for the one I have now, which is a four-door and whatever. I just love the thing, man. I just love it. You know what happened to me when I got a Jeep Wrangler? And it happens to me even when I'm here, man. I feel like everyone drives Jeeps. Like, I'm just driving, you know, and it's like, you don't wave to anybody in New England, but if you have a Jeep, you kind of like give them a quick little wave. It's like a Jeep thing. It took me a while, man. I just didn't feel comfortable. It was like I felt dirty waving to you. But even now, like, if I'm on the steering wheel, all you're getting is this. That's it. You're getting 3.5 fingers. I want some people, because they're just overeager waves. I'm like, I don't even like you like that. This is all you get from me. If you get the head, that means I'm really into you. That's it. But it was like everybody had a Jeep. I was like, everywhere I looked, Jeep here, Jeep there, Jeep everywhere. I was like, everybody. I was like, wow, everyone has a Jeep. Even on this trip, I'm like, everywhere I look, it's just another Jeep. And you know what the truth is? Nobody really has a Jeep. My senses are just aware of Jeeps. Nobody different had a Jeep. It's just I'm sensitive to it. And you know, when you open your eyes to something, it's amazing what you see. When you walk out of here with... You know, I always pray every Sunday when we release everybody. I'm like, God, we go into this week with our eyes wide open because you see a little bit more. When you walk out every day of full purpose and you are fully differently aware, life isn't just hitting you from the side. You're not waiting for drama. You're not moved by just disappointment, and you're not letting the next, you know, not the rage one in your life getting all the attention. And you start to take control of your surroundings. And you become aware, you see differently. And in those meetings, you know what people were saying to me? My sister called and I knew it was a divine appointment. Well, guess what? If they didn't have prayer, they would have just answered the call and said, oh yeah, sorry to hear that. And when you're aware, every single phone call, every single situation, you're a little more sensitive, and then you're ready to go. And I try to equip our church in such a way that every single week, when they face life, they're aware. When they're in business meetings, they say a word in due season. You know, we have people that sell insurance. They come in, they get filled up on Sunday, and they travel the world doing insurance stuff. And it's like they find themselves in meetings around all these people. And it's like they just speak a word and see people's lives changed. You know, we have people that manage like $8 billion in hedge funds. They're around some of the most wealthy people on the planet. And newsflash, they're not entertainers. We're friends with lots of real entertainers. And what are you going to make at best? $60 million and you're considered popular? That's not a lot of money. These people that handle hedge funds, they're making billions, friends. They'll clear $1 billion a year. I mean, men that really have money. It's not entertainers. And these people will get filled up in our meetings, and they'll be around these like guys that like got money, and God's given them words to unlock things and set people free. Because they're not just going to work. They're going with their eyes open in the reality of the supernatural, and they want to put their impartation into practice. and they're saying, God, you let that phone ring, I'm going to go for it. You put that business associate in front of me, I'm going to run that runway. You give me an opportunity. If somebody's sharing something's going wrong in their life, I'll speak that word. This is faith advanced. This is what it looks like when you pass faith exams. It's being faithful in every conversation, in every sphere that you're in every moment that you can stand for truth and looking for opportunity. And when you take it, God's like, you're going somewhere farther. Your faithfulness is going to be greater. You minister in this, it's going to be more. You speak that over your sister, your whole family will get saved. I mean, it's that kind of level. But I feel tonight similar, man. I mean, I feel tonight that God wants to give supernatural courage to those that would just say, I'll do it. You open a door in the next 24 to 48 hours, I'm going to run through it. You make that phone ring, I'm going to go to town. You cause that conversation, I'm going to go for it. You give me the runway, I'm going to land. You follow what I'm saying? It's just, you're going to get ruined now. And this isn't just like, tomorrow is going to be like everyone's sick. You're going to notice the van pull up at McDonald's with mentally retarded. I mean, you watch, you'll be ruined. You won't even be able to sleep anymore. You won't even be able to rest. Because you're going to be aware, and everyone will drive Jeep all of a sudden. And somebody's going to say something that's wrong, and you're just going to be like, you know something? Here's the truth. Or you're going to be in a situation, and you're going to be like, it's never been, it's always been like this. You're just going to become more aware. Let's stand. We're going to pray tonight. I feel faith for supernatural courage. I feel faith for this region. This church, this city, God is going to begin to restore some things. He's going to be ignite things in your heart again. I feel faith in this room tonight. I'm telling you, the souls that can be represented in this place, the people group, the nations represented in this place tonight. Thank you, Lord. Father, we thank you tonight for your presence. We thank you tonight for impartation. We thank you tonight for the stirrings of God in this place, Father. And God, we thank you in the mighty name of Jesus for divine appointments. We thank you for breakthrough. We thank you for realms of your presence. We thank you for the greater glory, God. And Father, tonight we thank you that you are using us in a radical way, that these faith exams will be passed by this place. That this house will be a house of healing. That these people will be flames of fire. That as a mission center, they're going to be going out to see lives transformed, saved, delivered, and healed. We acknowledge tonight in the mighty name of Jesus that there's no other life but the abundant life. That there's no other way than giving everything to your presence, Father. And in that name, we receive tonight all that you have. God, we receive all that you have tonight. Supernatural courage, God. Supernatural courage, God. Hallelujah. You know, I want to do that tonight. I want to pray for you. But I'm telling you, I want to say the same thing. If you're going to give God a commitment tonight, that in the next 2 days, you're going to open your eyes and you're going to go for it, I want you to come forward. I want to pray for you. You're going to be held to this. Of course, is everybody. Come on. Man, I feel courage tonight. He's going to take you at your word. He's going to take you at your word. Oh, doors are going to open. Oh, doors are going to open. Man, I feel a week of breakthrough. Oh, I feel divine appointments. Oh, Jesus, we thank you for the harvest. You are the Lord of the harvest, God. And we surrender all. We say yes. Come on, let's begin to pray. Let's begin to press in. Let's begin to worship. Oh, Father. Yes, God. Yes, God. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
I need a couple catchers. Follow James, please.
Thank you, Lord.
Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want, all I desire. Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want, all I desire. Oh, Jesus, take me, mold and make me. I yield my life to you. Oh, Jesus, take me, mold and make me. I yield my life to you. Oh, Jesus, take me, mold and make me. I yield my life. Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want, all I desire. Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want, all I desire. Oh God, you are my God. You're all I want, all I lay hold of God. We take hold of God. Lay hold on life, this eternal life. We take hold. Hold on, God. Will they hold on? This eternal signs and wonders now, miracles I hear. Miracles
signs and wonders now. Miracles are here. Natural signs and wonders, they hold God. We take hold of God. We lay hold on life. This eternal life. We lay hold of God. We take hold of God. We lay hold on life. We lay hold of God. Take hold of God. Lay hold on life. This eternal life. With signs and wonders now. Miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving in. Signs and wonders, your miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving in my life. Your signs and wonders, your miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving in my life. We lay hold. Take hold of God. Lay hold on life. This eternal life. We lay hold on God. Take hold of God. We lay hold on life. This eternal. Miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving in my life. Signs and wonders now. Miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving in my life. We lay hold on God. We take hold of hold on life. This eternal life. We lay hold.
Come on, declare it.
Miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving in my life. With signs and wonders, miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving, moving in my life. We lay hold on God. We take hold of God. We lay hold on life, this eternal life. Signs and wonders miracles I the Holy Ghost is moving, moving in my life. With signs and wonders, miracles I the Holy Ghost is moving, moving in my
You know, I believe that God has just released keys to you that are going to unlock doors this week. I just believe it so strong. So I'm telling you, tonight you have to believe that God has given you a key of supernatural courage. I'm telling you, this is how faith works. That when you walk out of this place this week, your eyes are open now. Every phone call, every conversation, every opportunity, that this week you climb in faith exams, that you declare the word, that you do everything that God is telling you. And that's how a life of great faith has began. Come on. Do you believe it tonight? Come on, let's give the Lord a hand. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord.
Miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving, moving in my life. Oh, signs and wonders, miracles are here. The Holy Ghost is moving, moving in my life. Oh, signs and wonders, miracles are here. Holy Ghost is moving, moving in my life. Who shines and wonders, miracles are. The Holy Ghost is moving, moving in my life. Shines and wonders, miracles are. The Holy Ghost is moving, moving in my life. Who shines and wonders, miracles I. The Holy Ghost is moving, moving in my this eternal life. We lay hold on God. We take hold of God. We lay hold on life. This eternal life. We lay hold on God. We take hold of God. We lay hold on life. this eternal life.
Don't leave tonight until you know that you've taken hold. Courage. That you've taken hold. Being aware of what God's going to do in these next 48 hours. Don't move from where you're at until you know that you have received and laid hold on it in Jesus' name. We love you all so very much. Just want to remind you, don't forget to bring your offering before the Lord. Remember, we're building a church in Oregon. So before you go, just come and give. We love you so much. Don't be in a hurry with the presence of the Lord.